This week at the Internet Cafe, Weird Science on the Web. This is the homepage for the Annals of Improbable Research, where you can find out about the weirdest experiments. This man is a rocket scientist who likes to drive fast, like 700 miles an hour. He wants to help set the world land speed record. Always wanted to be a gardener, but didn't have a garden? Check out the Telegarden, a virtual communal garden on the web. Plus, Weird Science software for you. Program X, a database of strange fringe science, and a clip from Young Frankenstein coming to you in our Cyber Blast. Weird Science on the Web, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. Connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet, here with Jane Wither, Andrew deVries. We're at CyberSmith in Palo Alto, California, a cyber cafe here in the heart of the Silicon Valley, and we're talking about weird science on the web today. Did you do weird stuff as a kid? Strange experiments?
So I had a collection of dolls that went on scientific
I don't mean those kinds of experiments.
No, I had a Planet of the Apes dolls, and Evel Knievel was a really huge doll, and we did these G-force experiments. We'd crank this thing up and shoot it off as fast as it would go, and we try to shoot it through people's windows. So
did you succeed?
We did, and I
broke
got in
a couple
trouble,
of windows.
And yes, and that was
child.
A whole other story.
Now, were you a very good little girl, and you didn't do any of this bad stuff?
Well, on the topic of the dolls, actually, no.
That's the valley of the dolls,
well,
not the topic.
Yeah, exactly.
That was your area of experimentation.
Really we yeah.
Well, I did a lot of this stuff. I was really into science, had the chemistry sets and stuff. You know, it said if you mix the yellow powder with the red powder, you get a lot of smoke. Well, I mixed a lot of yellow powder and a lot of red powder, got a lot of smoke and flames, and almost burned down my parents' house. So I've had a lot of experiments, experience in weird science. Today we're going to take a look at what you can find out on the web about weird science experiments this week here at the Internet Cafe.
So, Amy, you are a researcher at Stanford University, and you're also the webmaster for the Annals of Improbable Research.
Yes, I am.
I was up on the site, and I looked at it. It's very interesting. It's very hilarious. It seems to me like there's a lot of real science going on mixed with some real comedy, real humor. What's the site all about?
The site mixes real science and real humor. About 30% of the things we publish are actual, honest-to-God happenings in research.
So things that people are really doing experiments,
yeah.
Breaking it down.
Yeah. We don't know which 30%.
And it blends together.
Totally.
So what are some of the bizarre kind of experiments that you can find on there?
Some of our most interesting experiments are in a site, in a group called Shareware, which is things that have been sent in by our readers,
submit. You don't have to be a scientist to put information up here.
If you have a good idea and a good piece of research and an interesting happening, we might actually put it on the site. My personal favorite is something called the Spam Cam.
Spam Cam?
Yeah.
Kind of like David Letterman has the Monkey Cam.
What does the Spam Cam do? The Spam Cam is showing a progressive deterioration of various food items, including cans of Spam, but also for Thanksgiving, turkey and cranberry sauce.
So that's a fancy way of saying that things are rotting and you're watching
really
it happen.
Really rotting.
In real time.
Yeah.
Now, I was up on the site and I saw some other really crazy things. I saw a research experiment on the effects of photos of bearded men on cats. What's that all about?
The bearded men experiment.
Yes.
Well. Somebody did a research piece on how cats react to bearded men.
Now, did they really show photos of bearded men to cats?
We have a 30% chance that it actually happened. We don't know.
Now, is it true that the cats that were exposed to the Robert Bork photos actually became paralyzed?
Again,
you don't know.
We would have to trust their findings.
Well, okay, now one thing I noticed on the site is it does seem like you do have this comedy and you have real experiments. Mm-hmm. You have real scientists who are involved in this. Who are some of the people that are actually involved in this?
With AIR the Journal, as opposed to AIR the Website,
okay.
There are four real Nobel, not Ig Nobel, but real Nobel
laureates
on the board of directors.
Excellent. So those are folks who are providing some kind of direction.
Some kind of direction, yes. We do something called the Ig Nobel Prizes every year. And
what does Ig stand for?
I think not in
not
this case.
Not, like Ig Nobel.
Ig Nobel. Okay. Ig Nobel Prizes honor people whose experiments cannot or should not be reproduced.
And what are some of those? I think I've seen some of them, but what are some of the winners from last year that you thought were
interesting? This past year, the prize for let's see, the prize for public health went to a pair of researchers that tracked the transmission of gonorrhea through an inflatable doll, and that was published in a medical journal.
In a medical journal?
In a real,
that was a, so that was a real study?
That was a real study,
that's
yes.
Amazing. I won't even go into the details. That sounds kind of scary.
One of the other winners, which can be found under shareware on our site, on the website, tracked or looked at the effects of ale, garlic, and sour cream on the appetite of leeches.
Leeches.
Oh. And that got the prize for biology.
Wow, these are really appetizing subjects all the way around.
But it gets better, though. and the IgNobel Prize for Chemistry was won by a guy named George Gobel for a incendiary treatise on the lighting of a barbecue grill. He used liquid oxygen.
To just burn the thing, to light it.
A small
That's a good way to sort of cook your family at the same time.
he claims that one liquid oxygen-soaked charcoal briquette has the power of one stick of dynamite.
Oh, so this is not something you should try at home.
Not something you should try at home. But you can download the MPEG through our website.
And see it. Well, that's excellent. Great. We'll have folks go there. Thank you. Telegarden is a website that allows anyone from around the world to log in and tend to a real living garden. It's set up, and currently it's in Austria. And the garden consists of a 6-foot diameter planter with 18 inches of soil. And in the center of that is an industrial robot arm. The arm has a camera, color camera at the end, that can move around and look, take snapshots of the garden under web control. And also it allows people in the garden to pick a point and water plants that are there, and also to plant a seed. And planting a seed involves, the robot actually has a little suction cup. It picks up one seed, moves over, and then it digs down, digs a small hole, drops the seed, and covers up the hole with dirt, and then waters it.
Automatically.
Automatically. So then you have to come back, though, the next day, and water the seed again, and keep watering it over a period of a week or two until it sprouts, and then you have your plant.
So let me just qualify this again, because I think some people might get confused. This is a real live garden, and the garden exists in Austria.
Right.
And basically, through the internet, I can actually get through the World Wide Web access and become a member of the garden, or the cooperative in this case, and actually become a contributing gardener to the garden.
Right.
So I'm really watering a plant, and I'm really planting that seed. That's pretty exciting. Now, why did you do this?
Well, my research area is in robotics, particular manufacturing type of applications. And when the web came along, we realized that we could take the web a step further, in other words, beyond being able to pick up images and even live camera images, but also to be able to manipulate an environment at a distance.
Okay, so now, what's the experience? I mean, what kind of people would become the gardeners? Now, I know that you do have some rules in terms of how many hits you need to make to that website before you're allowed to have, you know, the right to plant a seed. Now, what kind of people are participating, and how many people do you have?
Well, the site has been up about a year and a half now, and we've had 12,000 people register to become members. We estimate probably about 10 times that have come in and looked around in the garden. To become a member takes a couple of steps, and you have to give your password, you have to get a password and share your email address. But we see it as both a science project and an art project, because we're interested in what kind of, raising some questions about what kind of communities are going to form on the internet.
Okay.
And so, in particular, what kind of community forms around a shared physical resource like a garden? I mean, if you go back 8,000 years when the first gardens came out, when people first started agriculture from hunting and gathering, there was a change in the way people interacted. They had to form groups, they had to defend some small territory. And then there was the idea of division of labor, that one person could plant and create enough food for 10.
So there's the economies of scale, I guess.
Economies of scale, and so people could start to diversify and do other things like science and art. And things like
So now, what's your experience? You told me a story earlier on about the fact that you did have an aphid infestation in the garden.
Right.
And you had to completely clear out the garden because of it. There's not much you could do. So what was the impact to the gardeners who created that garden?
Well, people are upset. I mean,
I can imagine.
Yeah, we get a lot of complaints that the watering is, somebody's been overwatering the garden, or that their seed didn't come up. We also get things like, when people say, I'm going on vacation, can someone water my plant while I'm gone?
That's great.
We really get neighborly kind
so
of
So there's definitely
like
a community that's been growing, literally growing up in this whole environment.
Right. And there are very suburban kind of interactions. There's a chat line built in. We call it the Village Square. And people can come there and talk about, well, we just leave it open. And they talk a lot about policies in the garden. It's sort of self-governing.
Self-governing.
But they also talk about their weather, their kids, their own plants back at their own gardens.
That's great. Well, thanks very much for your time.
You're welcome. Desiree, what I really like about talking to you is when you talk to somebody and you try to make the point that it's really not too complicated, you say, well, it's not rocket science. Well, this is rocket science.
Sure.
You are a rocket scientist. I mean, you're working on building a rocket, or I guess a jet, really, to go as fast as possible on the ground. I mean, you're trying to set the world land speed record. What's that involved?
That's right. It's Craig Breedlove's Spirit of America project. I'm his crew chief, and I'm assisting him in his endeavors to take the land speed record back to the United States from the British. Richard Noble has it right now. And ultimately to push his designed rocket jet car through the sound barrier.
And what is the record right now? How fast?
It's around 630 miles an hour.
630 miles an
yeah.
hour. What's the science here? I mean, what's so hard about this? I mean, it's easy to go faster. I take it the problem is staying on the ground
sure.
and steering the darn thing.
Staying on the ground, steering it, and then the material science involved with moving at higher speeds. The tires are problems. The aerodynamics is our greatest concern, one where as we get closer and closer to the sound barrier, transonic turbulence and then ultimately a shock wave may be forming off the bottom of the car and causing, at this point, unknown results.
What about the human factors? I mean, what's it like to be a human being inside this rocket ship that's going at 670 miles an hour?
Well, Craig's very calm at all times. He's calm when he's standing there and he's calm when he's driving, and it's something he's done all his life, but certainly a lot of stresses on him. It's extremely a lot of vibrations, a lot of noise, and ultimately, you know, it's
well, the last time he
dangerous.
Tried to set the record, things went wrong, right?
Well, yeah, he did a U-turn at 675 miles
not
an hour.
Not intentionally?
Certainly not, no.
I mean, the thing just got out of control.
Well, as we go faster, we start learning more and more, and what happened was we made a very rapid jump in speed. The highest speed he'd gone previously was around 560, and then we took an increase in speed of 100 miles an hour, and then forces either within the car and external ones, winds and slight winds, and maybe some changes in the aerodynamics are necessary, but yeah, he did a U-turn, and we're making modifications, but it's basically a new...
But he was all right. I mean, he walked away from this thing.
Certainly.
He's going to get back. This guy's 59 years old, right?
Yeah.
And he's doing this stuff.
Yeah.
Now, you've got a website, the Spirit of America, that explains all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us what's on the site.
What we have is information about the biography of Craig, his background with his other cars, a lot of information about his past.
You got pictures of the cars?
Certainly. And the new one, a lot
some
of
videos, specifications. Don't you,
yeah. I think there's some short-time movies, and we've got updates about where the situation is now, rebuilding the car, when we're going to start running it again, and what people can do to find out more.
Now, the enemy out there, you mentioned briefly, is this English guy who holds the record in another country named Richard Noble. He's got his own website. What's his story? How's he different from you?
He's not the enemy, but he's definitely a man we respect and keeps it competitive. But his website gives him a very good, a lot of information about his ongoing efforts. They ran this year
really
in Jordan.
Really cool picture of his car in there,
sure.
which is like,
beautiful
like
car.
Two jet engines, right?
Yeah, it's a twin-engine car with a central fuselage where Andy uh-huh. Green is his driver. And they'll be running again this year, I think as early as March.
Huh. Now, what is this fascination for you? I mean, you spend your life, you tell me you work 7 days a week, 20 hours a day,
just to
run a car faster than anybody else. I mean, what intrigues you about this?
Well, when I was very young, Craig was doing this before I was born, but when I was very young, I remember reading the Guinness Book of World Records, and I thought this stuff was extremely cool, and it was one of the things that kind of pushed me towards an involvement in science and in aviation, and I really wanted to do something that was generally inspirational. I felt like, you know, there's enough things that are not particularly intellectual in this world that are leading kids today, and I just wanted to do something that would...
So you can be into cars and grease and be a smart guy at the same time.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that.
And your background's aerospace. I mean, you're really building planes to stick to the ground.
Yeah, I'm a complete automotive idiot.
But, I don't know about that.
My background.
Thanks a lot, David.
Thanks.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you 4 files, a game, a database, a utility, and a sound clip. We'll be downloading to you more than 4 megabytes of data in less than 120 seconds. You can actually see the data downloading to your PC right now over here. To get these files this fast through the TV signal, you need an add-on card for your computer called a TV modem. We'll tell you more about that later. You can also download these files through our website using your regular telephone modem. Download time from the net on the phone at 28.8 will be about a half hour. Let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, we're sending you a very interesting shareware application called Program X. This is an integrated weird science database and analysis program. It includes information on numerology, astrology, ESP, UFOs, etc. It lets you analyze the information you gather in text and graphs. Next up, a program called Biosequences 32. This is a biorhythm calculator program that lets you chart the 3 major biological rhythms of your body, which govern intellectual, physical, and emotional aspects of your life. We're also sending you a cool spacey game called Q-Bob. If you remember the game Q-Bert, this is very similar. This is an arcade action game in which you have to get Q-Bob to jump around from asteroid to asteroid to demolish them before they demolish the Earth. Finally, if you love the Mel Brooks movie Young Frankenstein, we have a classic sound clip from that movie sent to you as a WAV file. Remember, we're sending all 4 files to you right now through the TV signal, over 4 megabytes of data in under 2 minutes, using our CyberBlast technology. If you need information on how to receive a CyberBlast or on how to buy or install a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at pctv.com. So the download is just about complete. Have fun with your new software. That wraps up this CyberBlast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Laurie Anderson.
So, Ron, you're the webmaster of the Exploratorium, which was one of my favorite places as a kid to go to.
It's my favorite place, too.
You've been there a while, you said.
Oh, it's been my favorite place for 25 years.
That's excellent. That's a lot of time. As a kid, I loved to go there. It was a way that I could learn about science and also kind of get wild. We were always confined in school, and they were like, we're going here. You can go get hands-on. You can touch things.
Finally, it was a place that said, do touch.
Exactly. Yeah. So tell me a little bit more about the Exploratorium and its origins of being a hands-on place.
Well, the Exploratorium was founded in 1969 by Frank Oppenheimer, and he did a survey of how people learn in museums and decided that this participatory method was one that was not being exploited quite a bit at all, really. And
no.
So he founded this museum to really get people involved in their own learning.
Excellent. And so what are an example of the kind of experiment that you would find there?
A good exhibit might be one called Vocal Vowels, where you learn about how sounds are made by your throat by actually injecting a buzzing sound, into a plastic model of your vocal tract.
See, that's perfect for kids. This is what they want to do, is get to sort of yell into something.
Yeah, it has
a
bellows. You make this quacking noise, and then you hear what it sounds like. And actually, that exhibit we've actually put on the web, so you can visit that exhibit,
too. Oh, excellent. Well, okay, that brings me sort of the next area, is now you've got this great museum. It's been very popular, very successful. I think world dignitaries have come and seen this place. Now you want to put it out onto the Internet. How have you gone about doing that, and what's up on the Exploratorium
site? A lot of it is exploring new technologies and ways to do that. Doing pictures and text is a good beginning, but it doesn't quite get there.
No.
So we've tried to exploit all the new technologies as they've come out, using QuickTime VR, using Shockwave, using sound, real audio, and all those kinds of things.
So you've got audio, you've got moving pictures, you've got animations. What are some of the exhibits that are up there now that kind of take some of these things into use?
Well, for instance, let's see. We have the cow's eye dissection, which has been a very popular one.
I remember that when I was a kid.
It is a wonderful exhibit that most people think is really gross, but once you get into it, it's pretty fascinating.
So walk someone through that. What is it?
In that exhibit, we actually will tell you how to dissect a cow's eye with pictures and with the explainers telling you with real audio how to go about those steps.
And it's pretty gruesome looking, even on the web.
Well, it's pretty gruesome looking, but it's one of the things you can't stop looking at either.
No,
it's,
in fact,
it's too fascinating.
I saw that you even had some
areas of like how to actually go find a cow's eye if you don't know where to get one in the community.
Yeah, you don't find, you could probably go do a Lycos search or an Alta Vista search for eyeballs,
right.
We tell you where to find them.
And so what are some of the other exhibits that are up there now?
Oh, well, the vocal vowels is one of them. We have some other larger kind of teaching things like Bob Miller's Light Walk, which will teach you new ways to look at light and shadow and images, that ways that you've never even thought of before. It's taught me whole new ways to look at that area.
And this is an interactive exhibit, or?
This is really it's a light walk that an artist gives and talks about light and images. And we sort of go on the walk with him in text and pictures. And then we have other activities that you can do after viewing that, building pinhole cameras and all kinds of other activities. And other places you go on the internet also to find related things, pinhole photographers and things like that.
Excellent. Now you mentioned photographer, and I have seen also the Nagasaki photos are up there.
That was a real
popular
exhibit that we did. In association with an exhibit at the Ansel Adams Gallery, we did an online version which displayed the photographs of this photographer who came back the day after the bomb was dropped, took these very compelling photographs. But in addition, we asked people to send in what their memories were of Nagasaki, of the atomic bomb or the bombing or learning about the atomic bomb. So you wouldn't have to be that old.
And posted those
And we posted those on the web, and people could have a discussion on the web then about the atomic bomb and its effects and
imagine
its
meaning. Was very meaningful, deep comments.
It was
as
amazing
well.
What people sent us. They sent us entire essays, that really well thought out, thoughtful commentary on their memories.
Right. Well, thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Pleasure.
Hi, welcome to the Twinkie Project. Here is our control Twinkie. Here is our water. Here is our radioactive Twinkie. Don't do this to your children. This poor Twinkie is a battery. It has so much power, it's not even funny. Look, it can run you for days. Try this with your Walkman. If you want more information about Twinkies, go to the Twinkie Project on the World Wide Web.
All right, not weird people. The show is about weird science tonight, okay? Would you guys calm down?
It's been a wild night.
All right, so what did you think? Did you have fun?
I had a great time. I think, my view on the world, not being a great scientist, although somewhat crazy in the kitchen, but I think what was neat for me was I saw an application of the internet in a totally new way, which was a place not where you go and gather information and take it back. It's a place where you go, you plant a seed, you come back over and over again to watch it growing and watering it and planting another seed.
Really two-way, real interactive.
Yeah, it was a whole different application for me, which I thought was
down this stuff.
Pretty jazzy, yeah.
And Mr. deVries.
Why couldn't you just do that in your house?
I do.
Oh, okay.
My cilantro is growing very well, thank you.
I like that there's some really fun sites out there for science. I always found science a little bit intimidating, a little bit even boring sometimes. This is a way to sort of make it fun. You know, this Annals of Improbable Research sort of poking, you know, jokes at the scientific community. And also the Exploratorium. It's always fun.
That
dissecting a cow's eye and do it online.
That sounds like fun.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. So
well, what I thought was interesting is, you know, we call it weird science, but you never know. Today's weird science can become the not-so-weird real science of tomorrow. My guess is people thought Galileo was a weird scientist at one point, and then all of a sudden he's right. So who knows what's weird and what's not.
What's next?
We'll see you next week right here at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. Connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor. Videotapes of the Internet Cafe are available for $24.95 each. To order your copy, call 1-800-916-PCTV. we'll help you stay on top of the rapidly changing world of computers and personal technology. Call today for your copy of this episode of the Internet Cafe or any of our other award-winning programs. When ordering, please ask for tapes by show number and title. That's 1-800-916-PCTV.